courteous and still. All right, I'm gonna go to my car and make an adult phone call.
All right, good morning, guys.
Good morning, Officer Rosen.
Okay.
A cop in a man bun, that's a cool look, sir.
Oh, thank you. Now, I'm here to talk to you kids about something that I call stranger danger. Sometimes, especially now around Halloween, you may find yourself wearing you're in a situation and you get confronted by a stranger without a parent or guardian nearby.
So far, so good.
Okay, now, let's say a man. He pulls up in the school parking lot, and he's in a van, and he offers you some candy.
Ooh, I like candy.
Well, we all like candy. But the question is, what should you do?
Whatever it takes to get that candy.
No, wait. Okay. The man says to you, all you have to do to get that candy is get into his van.
Get in that van!
Sorry, it's on me. I should have clarified. You don't know the man. The man is a stranger.
Oh, so then you go, what's your name? I'm Shallon. Where are you from? I'm from Orange County. Everything checks out, you hop in that van and get that candy!
Shalom. Shalom here is clearly misinformed, but she sounds very confident. And that may be throwing some of the rest of you off.
Well, why can't we just get in the van and get that candy? I mean, if we can't talk to him, we should just sit there and just eat all the candy in total silence? That's classic bad manners, man.
Yeah, that's disrespectful, Officer Rosen.
Yeah, you're mean, sir. You guys are missing the point. You don't talk to strangers, okay? Don't get in the van.
Whoa, Miss Officer, let's just back things up here. Now, for me, I'm all about candy. And if all I have to do to get said candy is y'all, the sweet man, I'm all about faith.
Yeah, Shallon's right. I mean, I'm starting to see vans in a whole new way.
Do you know how much candy you can fit in a van?
Right. Hey, you guys, there's a van out in the park lot. I'm still there after school. Let's approach and ask the driver for candy.
No, don't do that.
Officer Rosen, because of you, when I grow up, I want to drive a van and pass out candy kids. I love vans.
Wow, big day for vans.
No, wait. All right, you guys may have less of a handle on strangers than before I walked in. That's not good. Okay, Shalom, come up here, help me out. Okay, these guys seem to look up to you some. Are you the class leader?
Unofficial, no title, but that's pretty accurate, yeah.
Okay. Shalom and I are gonna do a scenario.
It's Shalom again.
Shalom, we're gonna do a scenario. All right, no candy in this one, or no vans, okay?
No vans? Oh, I hate this.
All right, guys, just wait a minute, okay? Now, let's pretend I'm a man. Pretend I'm a man, and I walk up to your friend Shalom in the park. And I say, hey, little girl, you want some candy?
You're probably a friend of my dad. Let's go.
No. I'm a total stranger to you.
Well, I don't know all my dad's friends. I don't even know my dad.
I'm not a friend of your father.
Oh, so are you playing my dad? What's up, Dad? I get why you left Mama's alone.
Guys, Shalom's
gonna drive with her dad!
Yay!
I'm not her dad!
Be a man! Take responsibility for your child!
This is not my child! Okay, can any of you even tell me what was wrong with this scenario?
Let me think.
There were no vans.
And no candy.
And the guy playing dad freaking sucked.
Shallon's awesome.
Yeah! Shallon!
I guess you could say I'm the vans of acting.
You know what? I think we're done here. Here. I'm going back to the precinct house before I tase a lot of you.
party.
Oh.
Symbolizing the solemnity of the moment.
Eagle, this is Houston.
Houston, is Eagle here? Yeah, Neil.
About your speech, we would like to make sure that you have something for when you step foot on the lunar surface.
Yeah, Houston, we do. Do you want to hear it?
Yes, please, Neil.
Way off's kind of saying, like, woohoo! Come on, you commie reach these suckers, bow on your belly. We're going to burn that, boy.
We'll get back to you on that one, Neil. Oh my god, we sent a couple hillbilly rednecks to the moon! It would appear that way, sir. I'm gonna contact the personnel department and see if we can't get a file on them. My god, the press is gonna shut us down for this! A hillbilly on the moon! Thank you. I just spoke to the personnel department. It appears that Armstrong and Aldrin are both fully competent and very qualified for the mission, sir. They're both from Grace Creek.
Well, thank God. You don't think they're pulling our legs up there, do you? A little astronaut horseplay, maybe?
Well, there is one thing, sir.
What's that?
I believe Neil wanted to take his dog with him, sir.
His dog?
It's a bloodhound named Elvis, sir.
Elvis? How did those two ever get to go to the moon? Don't we have some sort of screening for those types of people? Answer me! How did Armstrong ever get to go to the moon?
I believe he won a spitting competition with John Glenn, sir. It was close, but Armstrong just shaded it.
Okay. Look, you got 10 minutes to think of something to say, which won't make the USA look stupid or start a nuclear war. Get on to them and tell them to think of something more dignified.
Yes, sir. Eagle, this is Houston.
Oh, yeah, Houston.
Yeah, Neil, about your little speech. We like it. But we feel that now, since we've won the space race, we can be a bit more generous towards the Russians.
Generous?
Yeah, you know, we'd like to build bridges with them and open a dialogue. So we'd like you to have a thought. Perhaps take out the anti-Russian message and come up with an alternative.
So, no Russian message?
No.
How about just a little bit?
No.
Slide in?
No, Neil!
Okay.
Neil, we'd like you to come up with something a little more upbeat. Something that reflects the efforts and struggles to get you up there, while reflecting the bright dawn of a new age, that sort of thing.
Okay, okay, loosen up. Hey, did I ever tell you about when I was a kid, and the Kuczynskis were having a row? See, man, old man Kuczynski wanted a row.
Neil, look, in a few minutes you're gonna step into history books. We want you to say something inspirational, something lasting, something beautiful.
And she said you'll get with that Armstrong kid jumps to the moon. It'll be party time in old man Kuczynski shack tonight.
All right. Three small steps for Neil. We've got something there.
Yes, all right. Well, that is something.
Three small steps for Neil. Three small steps for man. We've got something there.
Well, you better make it one small step. That hillbilly might not be so good with big numbers.
One small step for man. I just can't get the rest of the line.
All right, we'll put it up to Neil and Buzz and see if they can think of something.
Yes, sir. Eagle, this is Houston.
Buzz, there ain't no way they'll let you put another gun rocket on the sun.
Will too.
Neil. Neil.
Yeah, you should go ahead.
Listen, we've got something, Neil, but it is not finished yet. We thought that you might be able to work with it.
Huh?
We thought that you might be able to work with this line. Okay, you know what? The line is one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Just repeat it, please.
Okay. One small step for man, a giant leap for mankind. Are you happy?
Yes.
Give him some encouragement.
Just like that. Just like that, Neil. Just say that line again at the bottom of the step of the ladder. Please, just say it.
Anyway. They should have to change my elbows. Just get that door open, buddy, and I'm going to go on it for a while.
Perfect. Love you.
Bye. Later on.
I'm going to bed. Getting really sleepy.
I jumped out of bed, wide awake. Grabbed the gun I always keep by me just in case my feelings get hurt or something. You know. Going around corners like the doing things, looking all cool like James Bond in silk jams. I finally get to the room where I see her the going off. And I realize it was my phone. Nothing like a text alert full volume at 3 in the morning to get the blood flowing. Someone actually texted me. It was my mom. Let's see. I read my mom's text first. It says, Grandma died? Dang it! Now I have two friends on Facebook! Oh, wow.
And the vehicle does belong to you, does it, miss?
Yes.
And your name is?
Right, give me a second. Are you ready?
Yes.
All right, my name is Anna.
What are you doing?
That's my name.
What is?
This, Anna.
That's your name?
Yes.
What? Anna is your name?
Yes.
What kind of name is that?
Well, it's my name.
A bit unusual, isn't it?
You know, if I had a pound for every time someone said that.
And how do you spell miss?
It's as it sounds.
Yeah, but I wonder if you actually wouldn't mind spelling it for me.
Well, I mean, can't you just?
I'd be very grateful if you wouldn't mind.
Fine, all right. NIPPL-E.
Nipple?
I beg your pardon.
Nipple?
Nipple? Where? What are you talking about?
NIPPLE.
Hyphen E.
Spells nipple. In my book, it does not spell.
What's the matter with you? Are you mad? The modern policeman was supposed to be a highly educated law enforcement. You can't even spell.
All right, Miss Nipple. What's your address? Your address?
Are you talking to me?
Yes.
You want to know my address?
Please.
I want to know Miss Nipple's address, whoever she is.
Your address, please.
Fine, all right. My address is number 22.
Watch it! Just watch it!
What for heaven's sakes?
You do understand assaulting a police officer is a very serious offense.
Yes. I imagine it probably is very, very serious. But telling a police officer your address, on the other hand, isn't very serious now, is it? Or is it? Perhaps the law's changed since I last looked. Maybe home security take extended measures against people giving their address to policemen whenever asked.
All right. The stupid person get a stupid answer.
I beg your pardon?
Can I just check this with you then?
What?
Just to make sure I've got this right, your address is number 22. Queens Lynn.
God. No. What's the matter with you? Are you deaf? I said number 22. Queens Lynn.
I'm sorry. I thought you said number 22. Queens Lynn.
Well, I didn't.
Sorry. I can't read my own handwriting.
Look at the bloody typewriter.
If only we could afford it. Actually, from some angles, this almost looks like number 22. Kings Lynn.
Girls meet me yesterday. Girl, he ain't even show up. Girl, I will cut him. That's the last time he had said that he didn't hook up with Tracy. Girl, I cut him. Okay, that's how I did, girl. Don't you see me in the middle of the conversation? Don't interrupt. Rude. Girl, I'm about to call you back. Welcome to King Burger. What we can do in your way, but don't get crazy.
Sorry. Can I get a number 6?
You can have a Coke. Let me get a number 6 with a large Coke. Next!
Hi. Can I get a number 3? No tomato. No cheese. And no lettuce.
Dang, anything else? I got a complicated order. Let me get a number 3 with no cheese. No lettuce.
Actually,
excuse me, sir. Don't you see me traveling my order? Don't interrupt. Rude. And no lettuce, that's it. What?
I changed my mind about the cheese.
Oh, now you have cheese?
Yes.
I asked you my turn in the first place.
I tried to.
Oh, no, sir. Don't get loud with me, sir. Do not get loud with me. Oh, no. Security? Security. This food needs to go. Needs to go.
Bon gui gui. I've had better days, Bon Gui Gui. I've had better days. Now look, how many times do I have to tell you? You can't call security just because someone has a complicated order.
Is that what you were saying?
Yes, that's what I had said.
Okay, you're right, Miss Please. My bad. Next, please.
Hi. Can I get a number 5 with a boneless skinless chicken that is slightly seasoned?
Ha ha, no security.
Bon Gui Gui.
Sir, she was trying to fight me, sir. No, I wasn't.
I will cook.
Oh. She's somewhere out of the hood program.
Oh, shoot. Hey, bye. I know you come here.
Let's go off that house.
Oh, okay. What you want to order, boo?
Well, let me get number 3.
Okay.
Instead of fries, let me get some of them onion rings.
Okay.
Thou, Silvius?
part that kills me is naive. I always thought it was naive, you know?
I never use it.
I mean, I heard of the word naive, but...
Come on, I got up at 5 o'clock this morning.
Listen, I know this sounds crazy, but would this feel a little while talk to me?
You act as though you were afraid to be alone.
I mean, I normally fall asleep with the television on or the radio, but my radio's on the fritz and it's too late for TV.
You know, it's too late for me too. I'm signing off. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light? This is Jenna Sherman signing off.
Hey, you know that's pretty funny. I never would have thought you'd ever have a sense of humor.
I mean, funny thing.
Just goes to show you can never tell about people. If you take one more step, I'm going to scream to the top of my lungs.
Come on, for God's sake, come on. Is there any other way that you have to fall asleep?
There's only one other way.
Yeah, I would not be interested in that.
Evil mind.
Hey. Well, I don't know what to say. We don't have any novels or bedtime stories.
Don't fall asleep. I mean, don't stop talking. Your voice is very unnerving. Hey. You know that word nervous, right? Oh, yeah, that's right. I told you before. Keep talking.
Okay. Let's see here. Oh. Ingredients. Wheat flour, oat starch, sugar, salt, cinnamon, sodium phosphate.
No, that's no good. I'm getting hungry. Hey, read me a story. Read me a latest one.
You wouldn't like it. 4 score and 7 years ago, our founding...
The Declaration of Independence, right?
Oh, no. Nope, Gettysburg Address.
Oh, yeah, that's why I knew that. What'd you stop?
I don't know, I forgot the words. Listen, I'm exhausted. I gotta get some sleep.
So much five, which I would've been with some dirty rotten bastard you and I both know, excuse my language.
All right, what do you want?
Come on, read to me. Read to me. Anything I fall asleep. Nothing but big words, though I hate big words. Well?
I could put you to sleep with Shakespeare.
No, Shakespeare gives me a headache.
Well, we don't have any comic books or magazines or any other literature of that nature.
That's right. Talking wasn't very unnerving.
You know, you should be ashamed of yourself. A girl like you afraid to be alone?
Isn't that ridiculous? Ever since I was a little girl, I can tell you it's not being alone that's scary. I wouldn't mind being alone, but there's someone there. If you just stand there breathing and it just panics me.
What'd you say?
Really?
Sure.
I said I was afraid to be alone because of unconscious guilt.
Guilt is very bad.
It's unnerving.
Okay, you know what? If you don't let me get some sleep real soon, you're gonna feel very innervative by guilt feelings tomorrow morning.
Hey, never mind, wise guy. Read me a story.
You won't like it.
Puts me to sleep, I'll love it.
Scream.
Scream? That's the title, right?
Yes.
That's a wild title.
Thank you. The sun spit morning into Werner's face.
The sun spit morning into a man's face?
Yes.
You're right, I don't like it, I hate it.
It wasn't written for you to like.
And why wasn't it written for me to like? I'm your puppet.
You're raising your voice.
The sun spit morning into a man's face!
Why are you getting so angry?
What right do you have to put a terrible thing like that into a story? The sun spit morning into a man's face.
Okay, so you don't like it, but calm down!
Yeah, look at me. Oh, I always get mad at stuff like that.
Just because you can't understand it.
It just makes me feel shut out, you know? It makes me mad as hell. You know what's up to a clock at the TV?
I kissed a boy once. Well, at least I tried. I don't know if it counts if they don't kiss back. But I tried.
Grandpa don't get to see folk much, but we go into town sometimes. And when we do, Graham tells me to be real careful to mind my manners. And Graham says I'm real good at being careful. But it just gets so boring in this little town. Only one video store, two churches, only two swings at the park, and a pool that never gets filled up. But in our little town, there's this boy named Samuel. He's the bag boy at the grocery store. He does it just right, never squishes the eggs. And he has red hair and green eyes and freckles all over his face. And he's so nice to me and Graham. He always says thank you and you're welcome. And when he says have a nice day, you did. That's how good he is at his job. I always wanted a chance to be close to Samuel, to be able to talk to him, but without Graham around. So one day, Graham got a bad cold, and I got to go to the grocery store all by myself. I picked up some oyster crackers and some medicine, and I got to watch Samuel do his bag boy job. I just stared and stared, tried to count every one of those handsome freckles. And then when it was finally my turn, and he asked if there was anything else I needed, I just whispered, yes. And then I grabbed him by the ears and mwah. My first kiss, the most romantic moment of my life, until the manager had to come pull me off again.
You know what I just did? I just walked through that door and I saw a couple detectives. I was gonna start bad-mouthing you behind your back. But my pops taught me, a man who bad-mouths another man behind his back, it's a coward. So I'm gonna say it to your face.
No, you don't have
to. I don't like it. I think you're a fake cop. The sound of your pee hitting a urinal sounds feminine. If you were in the wild, I'd attack you. Even if you were in the same food chain, I'd attack you. If I were a lion and you were a tuna, I'd swim out in the middle of the ocean and freaking eat you.
Okay, first off, a lion swimming in the ocean? Lions don't even like water. If you place near a river or some sort of fresh water source, that makes more sense. But you find yourself in the ocean, 20-foot wave, I'm assuming off the coast of South Africa, against a full-grown 800-pound tuna and 20 very of its friends, you lose that battle. You lose that battle 9 times out of 10. And guess what? You've won our tour school tuna, and we now have a taste of lion. We talk, we communicate, we say, wow, lion tastes good. Let's go get some more lion. We will develop a system of a beachhead to aggressively hunt you and your family. We will corner your pride and your offspring.
How you gonna do that, huh?
We will construct a series of breathing apparatus with kelp. We will trap certain amounts of oxygen. We'll be days at a time, hour, hour 45. No problem. That gives us enough time to go back to the sea, get more oxygen, and then stop you. You just lost at your own battle. You are outgunned and you are outmanned. That didn't go the way you thought it was gonna go, did it? Nope.
Hot coffee!
Oh my God! Oh! Oh!
I don't want to hurt anybody. I don't enjoy hurting anybody. I don't like guns or bombs or electric chairs. But sometimes people just won't listen. So I have to use persuasion and slides. My parents, Sharon and Dave, generous, doting, or were they? All I ever wanted was a ballerina Barbie and her pink tutu. My birthday, I was 10. And do you know what they got me? A Malibu Barbie. That's not what I wanted. That's not who I was. I was a ballerina, graceful, delicate. They had to go. My first husband's a heart surgeon, all day long, coronaries, transplants, sorry about dinner, dead, the Pope has a cold. Husband number two, the senator. He loved his state, he loved his country. Sorry, Debbie, no Mercedes this year, we have to set an example. Oh yeah, we'll set this. My late husband and his adorable family, you took me in, you accepted me, but did any of you love love me? I mean, really, really love me? So I killed. So I man. So I destroyed one innocent life after another. Aren't I still a human being? Don't I yearn and ache and shock? Don't I deserve love and jewelry? Goodbye, everyone. Wish me luck.
Joining us for this family communication session.
So what's up? You guys getting a divorce or something?
No, we just wanted the family to talk as a group.
All right, well, let's get started.
Okay, well, Stacy, Brian, your father, Ted, and I are a little bit concerned. Cecilia, the cleaning lady, was in the family room, and she found a bottle of pot.
Dang.
She didn't smoke it, did she?
No.
Now, we're not trying to come down on you. I mean, that's not what we're all about.
We're just concerned that pod each other's things.
Crack, ice, boom, pow.
Now we know you don't want to hear this from us.
Yeah, I mean, we're your parents. Who wants to hear this kind of thing from their parents?
Your father and I came up with a brilliant idea to give you kids some direction. A motivational speaker.
Yeah, you know, like one of those guys that speaks to big groups at high schools and churches.
He's coming here to the house.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, guys. This set me back a few bucks. All right, so his name is Matt Fulton, and he's been down in our basement drinking coffee for about the past 4 hours. Matt, we're ready for you. His speech is called Go For It, and he's used to big groups. Matt, come on up, buddy. All right, how's everybody doing? Good, good, good. Now, my name is Matt Foley, and I am a motivational speaker. Now, let me give you a little bit of scenario about my life. I am 35 years old, I am divorced, and I live in a van down by the river. I love you too.